Rejoice and be glad. Amen? Amen? Amen. It is wonderful to see you all here this morning. My name is Mike. I'm one of the pastors on staff. It is just a great day to have you in worship. We've got lots of fun stuff going on. A couple of things I want to let you know. First of all, if you're new or visiting, it is wonderful to have you here. We are blessed to have you here. We've got a communication card in the pew in front of you if you want to let us know who you are. You can just fill out as much as you feel comfortable with, and we'll keep you up to date on things. And if you want, you can stop by the Welcome Center, and they've got a little treat for you there. Just a little coffee pack. Say thank you for visiting. You want to drop, you can drop your communication card off there or over in the offering basket. And speaking of the offering basket, you can, if you want to support the ministry of this congregation and share the love of Jesus in our community, you can do that through there or text give to the number behind me or go to our website. We'll just... We want to help you give, and it's a way to worship with everything that we have. A couple other things going on. First of all, annual meeting. I know, it's everybody's favorite time of the year. It's like more important than Christmas and Easter put together. No, in all seriousness, annual meeting in 2 weeks, the 29th. It's after the 11:30 service. It'll be at 11:40, and we've got... It's important stuff. It's we vote to elect officers of the congregation, approve the treasurer's report, and then we're having soup and pie afterwards. If you want to sign up to bring soup or pie or dessert to share, we can do that out there. Also, want to let you know, we are having a fire suppression issue. So one of the things that we need to do is vote to approve an upgrade to the fire suppression system because it's more than 10% of the budget. So... It is a system that was put in 13 years ago when this building was built, and the design lifetime of that system was 10 to 15 years. So we're right in the middle of it. Got to replace it. So we will have a couple of meetings this week and next week over in the conference room right over there. You can ask the property team all the details on this. It is a really kind of fascinating subject once you get into it. But anyway, so step on over. You can stay for as long as you want. Ask as many questions as you want. Also, to let you know that one of the things that we do here is we have small groups, and it's a chance for people to get together, to read their Bible together, and be together. Two of them that I want to make sure you're aware of. Bible, which is meets on Mondays at 6:30 p.m., and they're kicking off a new series on Paul's life and his teaching. And then on Wednesday, there's a social group called Sheep's Head, which meets Wednesdays, starts at 6:30. And it's more of a social group, get together, play some games, and it's just kind of fun. So that's all the announcements that I have for this morning. If you would please rise. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Please remain standing for our opening song.
Spirit. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive with Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith.
Amen.
Let us pray. God of strength, your Son Jesus withstood many temptations because his love for you was greater than his earthly desires. Make our love for you so strong that we might withstand anything that threatens to stand between us and your love. We pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated, and I would like to invite our reader up for today, and this is also our time to dismiss our children for our children's church. You can go with our leader in the back, and then you'll be brought back to us after the sermon.
This morning's reading is taken from Matthew chapter 4. Then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. After fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. The tempter came to him and said, "If you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread." Jesus answered, "It is written, 'Man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God.'" Then the devil took him to the holy city and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. "If you are the Son of God," he said, "throw yourself down, for it is written, 'He will command his angels concerning you, and they will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone.'" Jesus answered him, "It is also written, 'Do not put your Lord your God to the test.'" Again the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. "All this I will give you," he said, "if you bow down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away from me, Satan, for it is written, 'Worship the Lord your God and serve him only.'" Then the devil left him, and angels came and attended him. When Jesus heard that John had been put in prison, he withdrew to Galilee. Leaving Nazareth, he went and lived in Capernaum, which was by the lake in the area of Zebulun and Naphtali, to fulfill what was said through the prophet Isaiah, "Land of Zebulun and land of Naphtali, the way of the sea, beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. The people living in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned." From that time on, Jesus began to preach, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." This is the word of the Lord.
Please rise.
Bye.
Usually I start out a sermon with some funny story or something provocative or a challenge just to kind of make the case to you as to why you should listen for the next 20 minutes, just something as a hook. This morning, I'm just going to say, I'm going to talk about temptation and the devil for the next 20 minutes, and that should probably just grab everybody's attention right there. If you want to go ahead and throw up that first slide, please. You see, what we're doing is we're walking through the Gospel of Matthew. And last week's story about the baptism of Jesus ends with the heavens ripped open and God the Father saying, "This is my Son, with whom I am well pleased." And immediately after that, Jesus is led out into the wilderness to be tempted. Now, this always raises the question, why? And it's a provocative question. It's a really interesting question. Why is Jesus in the wilderness? Why is he being tempted? Why is he being tested? Why does this happen? But here's one of the things for us. To a Jewish reader of this 2,000 years ago, to somebody sitting down who was familiar backwards and forwards with what we would call the Old Testament, they would just look at this like, oh, we're doing this again. Because this is the way God always deals with his people. This is the way that God always works with his people. They're led out into a wilderness, and it is a time of challenge. The best example, the biggest example, probably the most familiar example, is the people of Israel have been in slavery for 300 years. They go through God brings them out through the Red Sea, puts them at Mount Sinai where he meets them, and then he brings them to the edge of the Promised Land. And he says, "Do you want to go in?" And they say, "No, we don't want to go in. There's giants in there." And God says to them, "But I'm with you. I'm bigger than giants." And the people of Israel are like, "Yeah, but there's giants. Didn't you see the giants?" And God's like, you can almost hear the sigh through the text. It's like, "We're going to do it this way then." And so God takes them for 40 years in the wilderness and says, "You're going to be out here until you learn to trust me." Each of these times in the wilderness is a challenge, is a test, is a chance to grow or a chance to fall backwards. And intuitively, we know this. Intuitively, we understand this. If you ask me about my undergraduate career, and one of the memories that stands out for that, is I'll tell you, and some of you might have even heard me tell the stories, about what I always refer to as my toughest and best class I took as an undergrad. And the reason I always say that and I always pair those words together is because it was a tough class. It was a constitutional law class, and the professor would literally look down the class roster every day, just pick somebody at random, and he'd just be like, "Mr. Matzik, please summarize Connecticut versus Griswold." And God help you if you had not done the reading for that day. Not only the losing the points was the easiest part of that, but I loved the class because I learned so much, and I also learned how I could do. And those times of trial are when we learn. Those times of testing are when we learn. And the wilderness isn't something to be afraid of. About a couple weeks, I will have been here 3 years. And I will admit the last 3 years have been a blur, for reasons we're all familiar with. And I remember sometime, I don't quite remember when, I think it was in the middle of COVID, and I don't remember if you all were here, if I was just talking to the video camera. But I remember standing right here at this spot, and quoting this beautiful line out of the Old Testament where God says, "I will take her, nation of Israel, into the wilderness and speak tenderly to her." I will take her into the wilderness and speak tenderly to her. And it's a beautiful way to think about those times of wilderness, those times of challenge. It's not something to be afraid of. It is something to understand that God works in those and helps us to grow. So what happens here? So Jesus is fasting for 40 days and 40 nights, and the devil shows up at the end of that when he's tired and hungry and alone. And that's something to understand for us. That's when the devil shows up. That's when the temptation shows up. The devil never shows up when you've had a good night's rest and a nice breakfast and your favorite sports team has won the day before. It's not when the devil shows up, okay? It's those times, those ugly times, when he's there. And he shows up and he says, if you're truly the Son of God, turn these stones into bread. Now, I want to focus on that first word, if. This is the way the devil works. We get this image, we get this idea, and it has been done in countless movies and TV shows and more Twilight Zone episodes than I can count, which is awesome, but that's another discussion. We get this idea that the devil's going to show up in this puff of smoke and offer us everything we could ever want in return for a contract with our name on it, for our soul. I mean, I always loved the legend about the blues guitarist who was there at the crossroads at midnight and the devil shows up, says, I'll show you how to play the guitar for your soul. And friends, I have been at a lot of deserted crossroads in the middle of the night and nobody's ever offered me to show me how to play the guitar. Okay? It is not in those moments. It's in those little moments. If the doubt undermining, with the doubt saying, did God really say? That's how the Bible starts out. Genesis 3, devil shows up, says to Adam and Eve, did God really say this? It's not this big, giant choice. It's a thousand little ones, like water wearing away at a stream bed. There was a preacher by the name of Fred Craddock. He was like two generations ahead of me. And he was little guy, Appalachian twang, funny guy. And just this astute observer of human nature. And he had this observation that he always wanted to be this martyr. He always wanted to be that guy where the firing squad says, you renounce Jesus and you could go free. Or if you say Jesus is Lord, it's blindfold cigarette and up against the wall. And he's like, I wanted to be that guy who would say, give me the cigarette and the blindfold and put me up against the wall because Jesus is my Lord and I will proclaim it until you shoot me. And he said, and then I dreamt that they would sing songs about me and talk about me for generations afterwards. And he said, but it's never, ever that way. He said, it's the thousand little choices you make every day, every moment. And so Jesus says, look, you don't live by bread alone, but you live by the word of God. And so Satan comes back, and Satan takes him up to the highest point in Jerusalem, which is the highest point in the temple. And Satan says, look, if you're really the Son of God, throw yourself down, and the angels will catch you. And Jesus again responds with scripture and says, don't put the Lord your God to the test. And so the devil takes Jesus up to this high place where you could see all the kingdoms of this world. And says, I will give you all of this if you will just fall down and worship me. Think of it as going up to Holy Hill on one of those clear days where it looks like in one direction you can see all the way to Chicago and see all the way to Duluth in the other direction. And you see everything around you. And the hills go on forever. And the devil saying, I will give you all this. Now, I want to share an observation on this. I have been familiar with this story for I don't know how many decades, ever since I probably learned the story in Sunday school. At least I assume I did. But somebody made an observation a few years ago, and something clicked in my head. And they said this. They said, look, the devil says he will give every kingdom of this world. But can he? Can he deliver? And even if it's in his power, would he? He is the father of lies. And that just struck me. It's like some circuit snapped shut in my brain when I heard that. Because so often, we get this temptation out there, and we think if I just have this, everything will be right. And sometimes even if we give into that temptation, often, almost always, it doesn't happen. A number of years ago, I had somebody who I worked with, and they wanted my job. And it wasn't so much they didn't like me and didn't think I was doing my job, but it was like they felt they deserved the role I was in. They had gone to school, and they were just as smart as me and other experiences and everything else. But because of life choices they had made, they didn't get it and were never going to get it. And this guy and I would sit down on a regular basis, and sometimes we'd have a good conversation, and sometimes he'd be saying things that were smart and interesting and suggestive and helpful, and other times it was just we'd be banging heads together because I could just sense that frustration coming out. And it wasn't me, it was the frustration of wanting my role. And at times it just made both of us miserable. But here's the thing. If he'd been able to take over and do what he wanted, it wouldn't have satisfied. Because there was that hunger for significance, that hunger for recognition, and having my role. Trust me, it would not have given you the recognition you wanted. Okay? But then it would have just been the next thing. And the next thing, and there still would have been that hunger right there. Still would have been that pain right there. And the angriest, I was thinking about this, and I was having this discussion this week, about the angriest I've ever seen people in ministry. Not the angriest I've ever been, but the angriest I've ever seen people. And I was thinking about something, and that got me thinking about another thing. And that got me thinking about another thing, and another one after that. And I'm realizing, there's an interesting commonality. And it's when you're wanting something, and it's not in anybody's power to deliver. When it's not in anybody's ability to bring it back together. And sometimes it's some glorious version of the past. Sometimes it's a busted relationship. Sometimes it is just anger and frustration over the way things are. And those times of that huge anger, it's because I think people realize somewhere in their soul it can never be what they want. It can never be what they hope. So when the devil offers you that, whatever all those kingdoms of the world are for you, understand it. So why are we talking about this story for us? What does this matter for us? You want to go through that second slide, the one from James? Let me show you this. Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know this produces the testing of your faith, produces perseverance. Let's focus on that first line. Produces joy. Consider it joy. What do you mean consider it joy? Is this fun for anybody? No. But there's a truth in here. Let's go back to Craddock for a minute and those thousand little choices. Let me tell you a story. Probably about 10 years ago now, I got a phone call, and I don't recognize the number, so I pick it up, and I know what you're thinking, first mistake. But in my job, you kind of have to pick up the phone if you don't recognize the number, just the way it is. So I pick it up, and it's a telemarketer. And I'm like, okay. And I'm like, I listen for 10 seconds. I'm like, sorry, I'm not interested. Sorry, I'm not interested. Sorry, I'm not interested. And they don't stop talking. So I say, finally, I am sorry, I'm not interested. And hang up, okay? Hang up as angry as I can hang up. Because, you know, you can't slam the door, the phone down like you used to be able to. And then you actually like, stab at the button. Okay. And the thing was, I was so angry when I got off the phone. And I wasn't angry at the telemarketer, because the telemarketer is the telemarketer. It's like the wind and the waves. They just do what they do, okay? I was angry at myself, because there was what I want to be, what I know I'm supposed to be, patient and courteous and kind, and the way I was acting, kind of rude. And I didn't like that. And I was angry at them for forcing me to be in that situation. But in a way, that's a gift. Does anybody remember that conversation with the telemarketer? No, I remember it. Nobody else does. Sure, the telemarketer had much ruder people they were dealing with. I at least didn't swear at them. But it showed me something about myself. That was a trial I didn't handle as well as I should have. You see, these thousand little interactions we have with our friends, with our families, with the store clerks, with the people in traffic, with your coworkers, those all are those choice for where do we want to go. Those choice for which way do we want to pick? Do we go down? Do we respond as the world responds? Do we respond with the anger and the frustration in kind? Or do we respond out of God's graciousness and love? Think about all those fruits of the Spirit of patience and kindness and love and grace and mercy. And it's when we're filled with the Holy Spirit, when we are surrounded by people who support us and love us as Christians and call us to that level, that's when we respond in that way. Let me give you one last thought. The call to be transformed by the Holy Spirit, it's something that nobody looks at you strange if you don't do it. Think about the Apostle Paul. He makes these travels all over the Mediterranean basin, starting churches and doing all these different things and telling people about Jesus. And if he had done three of those and retired to some church in Corinth or Antioch and stayed there and preached and taught for the rest of his life, anybody have knocked him? No. It would have been amazing. But instead, he chooses to stay faithful and proclaim Jesus. And he ends up going to death in Rome. If Mother Teresa had spent 20, 30 years ministering in Calcutta in the slums and the poorest part, and then retires back to Eastern Europe to spend the rest of her days at a nunnery in Eastern Europe, and spends that time in prayer and solitude, would anybody have knocked her for it? No. But it's those trials and those things that made them into who they are, that made them into the saints that we think of, and were called to be transformed. And so I want to ask you, what are the trials that you're facing? What are those temptations that you're facing now? Not the big things, but those thousand little choices you're facing every day. And how is it you're called to be better? By the power of the Holy Spirit. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you so much. Thank you so much for showing us how you face these temptations. Thank you so much for this lesson and how to be more reflective of you and your glory. Amen. All right, we're going to take a couple minutes for offering time, for reflection time. This is a chance just to sit quietly before God, to sit, to think, to ponder, and also to give. We want to make sure that we have a space in the worship for offering. We're not going to pass the plate, but what you can do is I can either give out back through there. Don't feel self-conscious because 10 of you are going to break for the bathroom anyway. And you can always text GIVE to the number behind me, which you'll see on the screen in a minute, because that'll give you a nice secure link for giving, or of course you can go to the website. So I'm going to let the band play, and we're going to take just a few minutes to reflect and be quiet before God.
Using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He ascended into heaven. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Called together to follow Jesus, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need. You will respond with "Hear our prayer." Merciful God, we offer with joy and thanksgiving what you have first given us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions, signs of your gracious love. Receive them for the sake of him who offered himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Lord, in your mercy. Put a new song in the mouth of your church. Inspire the baptized to tell of your faithfulness, sharing the good news of your salvation throughout the earth. Bless the witness of missionaries. Lord, in your mercy. The waters of baptism calls us into life in the Spirit. Preserve the world's waters. Protect them from pollution. Support plants and animals who depend on them. And bring rain in places of drought. Lord, in your mercy. In Jesus, you are the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Show your mercy to all nations. Direct leaders to do your will. Fill governing bodies with righteousness. Equip judges with discernment and compassion. Lord, in your mercy. You incline your ear to all who cry to you. Draw near individuals, communities suffering with violence, injustice, illness, and poverty. Hide them in the shadow of your hand and make us signs of your faithfulness to all in need. Lord, in your mercy. You are glorified in the servants you have called. Give us bold trust in you, even when it feels like a sharp sword or a polished arrow. Give us courage to receive your call to repentance and justice. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for Judy Wagner as she recovers after being hospitalized. We pray for Jeff and Lisa Bishop's Uncle Jack recovering from surgery. And together we pray for our brothers and sisters at St. Jacoby Congregational Church in Richfield. We pray that God would bless them and pour out the Holy Spirit on their community. Lord, in your mercy. In every place and time, you have sanctified your people. We praise you for the testimony of those who have died in the faith. Strengthen us as we wait for the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, in your mercy. We bring our needs to you. We bring our hopes and needs to you, O Lord. O God, trust in your wisdom and power revealed in Christ crucified. Amen.
We will now continue our worship with the Lord's Supper. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty, and our joy that we should at all times, in all places, give thanks and praise to you, almighty and merciful God. Through our Savior Jesus Christ, you comforted your people with the promise of the Redeemer, through whom you will also make things new. And in the day when he comes to judge the world in righteousness, and so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Our Lord Jesus was betrayed, he took bread. He gave thanks and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, for this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup and he gave thanks and he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me. And let us pray in community the prayer our Lord Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and power, and glory, forever. Amen. God's table is ready. You may be seated, and we believe that all who believe in Jesus Christ are welcome to God's table. An usher will excuse you, and you can come down the center aisles, and we invite children up for a blessing. I would like to invite our communion assistants up at this time.
Thank you.
that you please rise if you are able. And may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Now our worship does not end, but it does change form. As we go into this world, we worship with everything we have, our work, our actions, our possessions, our relationships, until we come back together and worship as a body, whether here in person or online. And as you go, take this benediction with you. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May his face shine upon you. May he look upon you with favor, grant you his peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please remain standing for our last song.
Thank you.